Verse 1, it's on page 1158 in your church Bibles. Let's go ahead this morning and begin with prayer if we could. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for another Sunday, for another day, an opportunity to come together in this place that you've given us for now, to worship and to study your word, to grow in the grace and the knowledge of God, and to have fellowship and eat together once a week. As we bond in the faith and in our love and care and concern for one another, Father, I pray that you would bless this fellowship today, bless the service today. Speak through me, Father, and open up our hearts that we might hear what the Spirit has to say to the church here in these last days. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Apollos wanted to go to Achaia. See, I remind you that he was in Ephesus. Ephesus had become a very prominent church over there in the Galatian region. And Ephesus ends up being the church Paul spent the most time at. He was there for 3 years. He was at no other place that long. You remember as we went through the book of Acts, he wasn't anywhere very long. But he ends up on his third missionary journey. He makes his way from Antioch of Syria over to the Ephesian area to fellowship with them at the Ephesian church. Speaking of the Ephesian church, it's one of the seven churches in the book of Revelation, a letter written to the church of Ephesus, you remember. And it ends up being the church where John the Apostle, the one exiled to the Isle of Patmos who received the book of Revelation and the vision, he was released before he died, and he went over, extra biblical history tells us, that he finished out his life at the church of Ephesus. He was the pastor there. So the church is very significant. Most believe it was founded by Apostle Paul. Paul preached there, Timothy pastored there, and ultimately John the Apostle was there. So very significant church. And this is where Apollos is. And Apollos, if you remember in our last chapter, was beginning to take a place of prominence. He was beginning to be used as a minister in the church. He had great skill, and he was gifted in that way. But he was only versed in the baptism of John. He didn't fully understand the gospel of Jesus Christ, only that Christ was coming, and he had been disciplined in the message of John. But you remember Priscilla and Aquila pulled him to the side, the Bible said, and filled in the gaps for him, helped him to understand more clearly. So now he's really up and running. And he wants to go over for some reason, it doesn't tell us in the Bible, but he wants to leave the continent of Asia Minor there where Ephesus is, and he wants to cross over to the continent of Europe, and he wants to go to Achaia, which is the western part of Greece, right there next door to Corinth. And we know there's a Corinthian church there because Paul later writes a couple of epistles to the Corinthians. So he wants to go there, and the reason I'm bringing this up is there's a really good principle here that I didn't get into last week, and I'm going to hold this. This is going to bug me the whole time. I need to take that with me, that way I'll remember. I need to take this with me too. It's broken at the bottom. We got to fix it. We've put some wear and tear on stuff here in the past couple of years. Got a speaker a little on the blink too, but it's time to fix everything. But there's a principle here, if we will notice. A principle is demonstrated, I think, here in verse 27 of our previous chapter. If you notice, it told us in 27 that once Apollos tells them that he wants to go over to Achaia, the Bible tells us that the brothers from Ephesus, where he's at now, they end up sending a letter ahead of him to the believers there in Achaia. And they tell him in the letter, you know, that they are to receive Apollos and welcome him in. Now, that's a very significant point in the sense that it demonstrates a principle I call sent versus went. You know, you may have heard me say it before, but some have said that some are called, some are sent, and then others just got up and went. And it's always better to be sent. And of course, the sent comes after the call. You know, God calls us, and then he's arranged the church in such a way that your calling is recognized within the church, you know, among the believers and other leaders who are already there. And from there, you're confirmed. You know, you receive spiritual affirmation. This begins to build you confidence, and it's a witness to what God has already placed in your heart. But then you have those who just went. They don't look for any confirmation among believers. They just have a brainstorm sometimes. You know, they have a feeling, and they just jump up and they call themselves this or that, self-proclaimed prophets or messengers or ministers, and they're just on the go. And problem with that is, in every case, at the end of the day, they do more harm than good because they're self-appointed. And the principle God has laid out for us is absolute because it's grounded in his word. I take you back to Jesus himself. If ever there was a man who could have just said, here I am, you know, listen to me, I'm now going to tell you how to live, I've got a word from the Lord, it could have been Jesus. But Jesus went and submitted himself to the baptism of John, to John's ministry, before he ever set out and began his ministry. And it was so unusual, you know, that John himself looked at Jesus when he approached for baptism and said, wait a minute, you know, I should be baptized by you. And Jesus said, John, suffer it to be so, for we must fulfill all righteousness. In other words, Jesus was setting the example. He was leaving for us a pattern. And we're told over in the book of John, chapter 20, verse 21, Jesus said, as the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. This is what he told his apostles, his disciples, before he ascended into heaven. When his ministry was finished, he had rose from the dead. He had spent 40 days appearing to them, different times, different locations, fellowshipping with them, filling them in on what their mission was to be and the different things that we find written in the scriptures about Jesus' resurrection. And when that come to an end, and at the end of the 40 days, he was about to ascend into heaven, this is what he told him. As my Father has sent me, so now I am sending you. Once again, lending a foundation, more credibility, and the absolution of the principle, we need to be sent. First we're called, which means God is sending us. And then we reach a confirmation among the brotherhood. You know, this is the way the Lord does things. And so we find that this principle of being sent is just a manifestation of our purpose and our calling. See, it's you cannot uncouple it from the fact there is a calling and there's a purpose for each and every one of us. And, you know, it's kind of like parents. Sometimes parents will tell children, and you've probably seen this, whether it's in a movie or you heard about it, or maybe you're the one that done it. You know, you have a daughter that's just so cute, you know, or she just stole your heart away, or a son that's so smart, and you end up telling them when they're real little, you can do anything you set your mind to. Don't let anybody ever tell you any different. Whatever you dream, it can come, it can happen. You can do anything, you know. Parents are bad about that, just telling their child they think somehow that is a positive affirmation, and that's going to give them the courage and the belief in themselves, and it's going to help them. And some kids grow up, and as they grow up, they gain wisdom and understanding, and they look back and realize you were wrong, and it's okay for them. But some kids don't. They grow up, and they're adults, and they're being humiliated, and they're being, you know, in these depressing situations of rejection and all these kind of things because, well, you raised them to believe they could do anything. And it's simply not true. In Romans chapter 11, verse 29, it tells us the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. That means whatever God's call is on your life, whatever His gift to you is, it's irrevocable. It can't be changed. So you may tell Susie, you know, Susie, oh, you want to be a ballerina when you grow up? Well, you just pursue that. Don't listen to anybody. You can do it. Well, God may not have called her to be a ballerina. He may have called her to stand up here and lead worship in a church. You just never know. There's gifts and there's callings. When it says in Romans, these gifts and callings are irrevocable, it means that God places a call in each of our lives. There's a purpose for us that God made us for. Remember Jesus when he stood before Pilate there at the judgment seat, and Pilate was interrogating Jesus, and he asked him, he said, "Are you a king?" And Jesus said, "For this purpose was I born, and for this purpose came I into the world." See, Jesus was born to be a king. He was born to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he went on to tell Pilate, "That's not all, but I was sent to bear witness of the truth." Pilate said, "What is truth?" Kind of a weird, you know, question. What is truth? I remember reading that the first time thinking, and the second time and the third time and on every time I'd read it, I'd be like, what's he talking about? Pilate is this great leader, you know, in power, and he asked Jesus, "What is truth?" And then it dawned on me just recently, I thought, well, wait a minute. Maybe their culture was in the same condition ours is in today. We live in a culture today when people will outright ask you, "What is truth? What do you mean truth?" It's like a foreign concept. To them, truth is relative. When I say relative, that's the terminology they use. What they mean is it's relative to you, your truth, my truth. Truth is whatever we deem it to be. If I say I don't think I'm a boy anymore, that's my new truth, and you have to respect it. Or you could actually get in trouble. You could be canceled, as they call it. You could lose a job over it. You could be ostracized, humiliated, put down, persecuted. All because you won't buy into someone's delusion. And that's just one of many examples. Today, they tell us, people that are educated, highly educated, they tell us today, they even write books about it. It's a philosophical point of view that truth is today seen as relative. In other words, there's no standard anymore. There is no absolute truth in our culture today. They believe that's a concept of the distant past, that it's archaic and we've got to let it go eventually. The truth is relative to your experience. It's relative to your education. It's relative to your thinking. It's relative to your delusions in some case. I remember reading an article where a woman married a dolphin. And there was a picture of it. She's down by the seashore. And there's some, well, I almost said a word there. There's a very dumb person down there dressed up like a minister performing the ceremony. That's just insane, you know. But that's her truth. In her world, in her mind, in her fantasy, it's perfectly normal to marry a mammal from the sea. Just crazy. So we tell our kids sometimes, and it's not always a healthy way to raise them, you can do anything. Johnny, you're so smart. You can do anything when you grow up. You can be a brain surgeon, an astronaut, just son, the sky's the limit, whatever. You can do anything. And we set them up for failure. How many times have you seen things like, for instance, you remember the show, I don't know if it's still on or not, but there was a show called American Idol. My favorite part of the show was the tryouts. Anybody here ever watch the tryouts for American Idol? And you have to admit, it may sound mean, but you have to admit, the funniest thing was watching the people that couldn't sing. I mean the ones, not just the ones that couldn't carry a very good tune, but the ones that were really bad. I mean, and the ones that were the worst are the ones that thought they could sing, because they would put their whole heart into it. And usually they couldn't dance either. And they'd be putting some crazy, weird-looking moves in there, raising their voice, trying to show off all of their range, you know, they got in their singing voice. And you're just like, you feel so bad for them just watching it. It's painful. And then you look and it shows the judges. They're like covering their faces and some of them are, you know, and they're just about to bust out laughing. And it's astonishing. I can't tell you how many times I watched it. I'm like, how does this happen? Is that person deaf? Can they not hear themselves? You know, and a lot of times one of the judges would speak up finally and say, who told you you could sing? And what did they say a lot of times? My mom, that's right. My grandmother. One said, oh, many people in my family said I could sing. See, we it's not good to tell a kid they can do anything because they can't. Some can't sing. Some can't build, some can't paint. I know guys, I'm a painting contractor. They come to me, they've been painting 20 and 30 years, and they're convinced they're a painter. And after painting that long, they should be. They don't even know how to hold a brush or set a ladder sometimes. And I just shake my head. I'm thinking, how do you make a living, you know? And of course, you find they go from job to job. They can't really find full-time employment as a painter because everybody they work for realizes they can't paint. But they're convinced that they're a painter. But it's obvious God didn't call them to that profession or they would have some level of skill in it. So it helps us to go back and realize that the Bible tells us here in Romans 8 that, in Romans 11, that these callings in our life are irrevocable. That is, God places a calling in your life. And with that calling, He gives gifts because it says the gifts and the callings. So with your calling, you've been equipped. See, sometimes we'll have a calling for something and we'll have a deep desire for something and it just won't go away. And that is a good indication that you're being led toward what God created you for. You know, if it's not just a temporary, you know, idea or brainstorm, but it's something lasting, it sticks with you. You have a deep, abiding, you know, desire to do something in life, a particular thing, a certain vocation, you know, a certain position in the church. It's a good indication that that is your calling. That is what God has placed in your heart. And with it, you're going to have the talent for it. You know, it may be raw at first. Doesn't mean if you feel called to sing and lead worship that you're going to sing like a professional right from the start. But it does mean you'll probably be able to carry a tune from the start. There'll be something there that's an indication you have the gifting for it also. Might need to be refined a little bit, like anything. But they're irrevocable. God puts these things in our life. In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, it says, and we know that all things work for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. Now, that's a very popular scripture. We've all heard that a lot of times, you know, in our Christian life. All things work together for the good of them that love God and are called according to His purpose. Notice there again the two words, calling and purpose. See, it keeps coming up in Scripture. All things work together for that calling and that purpose. Notice that. Which means that if you're not in God's calling and in God's purpose, not everything's going to be working together for your good. Sometimes we quote that scripture as a blanket scripture. I've done it many times because it's very encouraging in times of trouble, depression, and problems and crises. It's good to remind ourselves. As a Christian, you know, you're like, okay, Lord, all things work together for my good. Somehow this is going to come out in the end for my good. You know, whether you banged up your fender on the car, or you've, you know, come home and the house is burnt down, God forbid. You know, I know a man who his house just burnt down one day. Didn't even have insurance on it. He was homeless for the rest of his life. But this man wasn't a Christian. I remember I had gone to this man many times and tried to talk to him about the Lord, and he just wouldn't go there, you know. And I'm not saying that's why that happened. I'm just saying these things happen. Problems happen. Crises happen. Disasters happen. But a Christian has, we have that assurance. We have the promises of God that tell us all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. So I only bring that up to remind us that if we're in His purpose, if we're in His calling, then all things are going to be working together for us, for our good, even if it momentarily looks bad at times, even if something don't turn out quite right, even if we're going through a tough time, God is going to take it, and in the future, it's going to be, whether it's immediate future or long-term future, way off in the future, whatever you're going through is going to be used for your good. It can serve as a good experience. It can serve as an education. It can prepare you for something that God is got for you up ahead, because His purposes, they require educating along the way that you might be prepared for them. So let's turn over. That was a really long preliminary. I haven't even read our first scripture this morning. I've read scripture, but not the one in our study. We're in Acts 19, verse 1. I'm going to turn over there in the Bible. You guys are probably already there, those of you that are. This is concerning Apollos, we were just talking about. The brothers had sent the letter ahead of him, and that's what brought up the principle. He was sent by the brothers. They prepared the way for him with their preliminary letter they sent ahead of him to get the church that he hadn't been to yet to receive him. Because see, the church that he's going to knows about the church of Ephesus. Like I said, they're a very prominent, significant church, but they may not know Apollos yet. They may probably never met him. So they're taking the word of the church. And it says in verse 1, "And it happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the inland country and came to Ephesus." Now here, notice Apollos leaves Ephesus. Paul shows up at Ephesus. These guys are always in separate locations because these are they're kind of like the generals of ministry. Just like in a war, you don't want all your generals in one place. That wouldn't be a good strategy. God, if you notice, throughout the book of Acts, He keeps His most significant ministers and figures in different locations. He doesn't let them all congregate in one place to do ministry. That just wouldn't be profitable. It says, "There he found disciples," talking about Paul, he found some disciples in Ephesus, "and he said to them," verse 2, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They said, "Into John's baptism." And Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was to come after him," that is Jesus. "On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in tongues and prophesying. There were about 12 men in all." Now, it is believed that these disciples that Paul came upon were probably the disciples of Apollos. Apollos just left this place, right? He just left. It tells us Paul comes in, immediately meets some believers, and discovers that they only know about the baptism of John. They don't know about Jesus yet. That is, they know that John was baptizing, preparing the way for Jesus, but they don't know about the baptism in Jesus' name yet. They're just baptized unto repentance. So Paul here has them rebaptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, it tells us. And and it says they receive the Holy Spirit. In verse 8 it says, and he entered the synagogue, that is Paul, for 3 months, spoke boldly, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. But when some became stubborn and continued in unbelief, speaking evil of the way before the congregation, he withdrew from them and took the disciples with him, reasoning daily in the hall of Tyrannus. This continued for 2 years, so that all the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. Now you notice here, this is the place and this is the time that Paul spent 3 years in Ephesus. It just tells us here that he continued here in the hall of Tyrannus preaching and teaching for 2 years. But he'd already been here a while, and he stays even longer after this, because we're told in the next chapter, in chapter 20, Paul is telling the Ephesians as he's leaving them, he's bidding them farewell, and he ends up telling them, I've been with you for 3 years. You know, I cease not for 3 years to admonish you with tears, Paul said. So we know he's here a total of 3 years. And the hall of Tyrannus, you notice he leaves the synagogue because he says they become stubborn, they remain in unbelief. Like most synagogues, almost all of them Paul ever went to, he's not received well among the Jews as well as he is among the Gentile believers, or the Gentiles who he brings into a faith with the Lord. And he leaves there and goes to a place that says called the Hall of Tyrannus. That's all it tells us. We don't really know what that is, other than Tyrannus is probably someone's name and the hall belongs to him. So Paul is more than likely, he's renting a place, kind of like we are here today. You know, he's renting a hall, he's renting a room, and he stays there, you know, for the next couple of years. And from here, Luke tells us, because Luke wrote the book of Acts, he tells us that the word prospered, and all the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. In other words, his ministry was very prosperous at this time. He finally got settled in somewhere. You know, he met up with opposition. Through opposition, God moves him, manipulates him, gets him in the hall of Tyrannus, and suddenly he's there for a couple of years, which reminds me, we've been here, you know, around 2 years and in this place. And sometimes that's what happens. You get settled in somewhere. Before we landed here for a couple of years, we were, you know, we were in one restaurant, then we were at my dad's house, and we had service in an office complex down the road, and then we were back, I think, at my dad's house. And, you know, we were moving around, and it was a little troublesome. But then we wound up being settled here, and, you know, it's been going pretty good here. We've been able to minister to a lot of people. We've had a lot of folks come and go, people who are doing community service here across the parking lot. We've had many of them come down here, and some have stayed. We had one fellow stay a couple of months. And, so we've been able to share the word of the Lord with a lot of people since we've been here. Also, if you notice here, it says in verse 9, I just want to point this out, it says, but when some became stubborn and continued in unbelief, speaking evil of the way. If you notice right there, way is capitalized. That's what they called Christianity. You remember the Bible tells us Christianity was first called, they were first called Christians, that is the believers, were first called Christians at Antioch of Assyria, which became the new headquarters. You know, went from Jerusalem to Antioch. You know, as the Gentiles begin to take the prominence and the Jewish believers begin to kind of fade in prominence. You know, there was a transition we talked about that took place. Still taking place here in the book of Acts and continued until Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. But it was called the Way before it was called Christianity. Some of you here probably remember I preached at a church called the Way. And that's what they actually called their church. And they were using this ancient name of Christianity. That's why they call their church that. And that's why they capitalized it here. It is I guess you would call this a proper noun in English. So in verse 11 it tells us, and God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul. This is during Paul's success in ministry there. He's not only reaching a lot of people, he's starting to see signs and wonders. It said, and God was doing extraordinary miracles, not just regular, but extraordinary, by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and or aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook, itinerant, that just means they were traveling exorcists, undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul proclaims. Now this is an interesting story right here. Pay attention to this. This is it's kind of funny. Now, let me set the stage a little bit before I read any further. Now, Paul is doing miracles. His fame is beginning to spread in this area. People are hearing about the gospel in relation to Paul. They're hearing Paul's name. They're hearing Jesus' name a lot. You know, people are like, hey, this Paul guy that. I hear there's miracles going over there. He's doing it all in the name of Jesus. So these names gain notoriety. And even these handkerchiefs and these aprons, you know, that is, workers sometimes wore aprons in certain trades. They were getting these from Paul. The people begin to look at Paul in such a way, you know, because of the miraculous and what's going on, that they wanted to take a handkerchief, an apron, anything they could that had been in his possession, and they would take it to sick people. And they were seeing healings from this. And I don't know how many of you know this, but that's become a common thing among some of the old-fashioned churches. Even my grandfather, who died back in 96, but he was an old-time holiness preacher, and they did that. They had these cloths they would cut into squares, and they would stamp the name of their church on it. Some places actually put a print of a hand on it, just different things. And preachers will pray over these cloths, and then they'll send them out, and if you want one, you can get one. And it's supposed to help you, you know, in your faith, and sometimes people report having miracles occur because of it. Now, somebody might ask, Frank, how is that possible? Well, I don't get that. It is kind of strange, you know, out of the ordinary. But remember, the Bible said here, it was miracles that were out of the ordinary taking place in Paul's ministry at that time. But what it is really, is it's a point of contact. It stimulates faith. You know, a lot of times people will have a problem, have a sickness, might be going through a financial struggle. I've seen all of these things over the years. And they just struggle. And then all of a sudden they meet up with a preacher. They go to church. They come forward for some special prayer. The preacher prays with them, you know, listens and counsels with them a little bit, gets their faith stirred up. Next news you know, they go out the doors and the problem solves immediately, whether it's a healing, whether it's, you know, their financial problems suddenly evaporate. You know, and they come back testifying, wow, it really worked, you know. What you told me really happened. We believed. And it was a point of contact. Their faith was stirred. You know, the Bible says in one place, stir up the gift that is within you. You know, sometimes we have faith, but it's like the Bible said, without works, faith is dead. See, faith without works, James said, is dead. So sometimes we can have faith, but it can become dormant. From a lack of attending church, from a lack of reading our Bibles, from a lack of listening to, you know, Christian music, always instead listening to secular music, from a lack of watching anything wholesome on TV, you know, we can get into a condition to where our faith is suppressed. And we still believe in God when we're asked. You ask people, yeah, I'm a Christian. Oh, yeah, I believe in God. Or, yeah, you know, 20 years ago I was baptized. And there's a faith there, you know, from long ago, but it's just kind of covered up and it's dormant. But they can get around other believers. I've had people on the job before, you know, work for me. And they would tell me later, after a few days, they'd be like, Frank, man, I tell you, it's really affected me working on your job. You play that Christian music all the time. You got Bible tapes playing. You talk to me about the Lord. Next news you know, they're back in church just from working with me. Had that happen a few times. They're back in church. Their faith is reignited. They're telling me about their experiences when they first came to the Lord so long ago. And I'm like, well, that's wonderful, you know. And I realized it was my work environment that I created that helped generate their faith and uncover it and reignite it and resurrect it, you know. And that's what these cloths do, you know. They knew they came from Paul. It was a point of connection. It would get them stirred up. Oh, this cloth came from him, you know. And they would hold that and pray. And I'm going to tell you something here right quick, if I could. This is a story. My wife may see this coming. But we, long, long time ago, when we were really young, we were going to my grandfather's church back before he died, and I got a prayer cloth from one of the services. Every so often, they would pray over cloths, usually by request, and then people would come up and get one. And so I carried one in my wallet, a prayer cloth. And Kelly, do you remember, were you pregnant with Felice at the time? This was so long ago, I'm having trouble remembering. Was it her, Angelina? Yeah, I can't remember either. That's how long ago it's been. But she was about to give birth either to my first daughter or my second. I don't remember. My daughters may remember this story. Was it Angelina? Okay. Well, no, we were at the hospital, so it must have been Felice. Yeah, because we just let the cat out of the bag, didn't we, Angelina? She was born at home with a midwife who was running late. We won't get into that story, but it was Felice then, my first daughter. We were in the old time holiness church, and you know they taught there that it was best that you only work with women. You know, the women go to women to have children, and preferably midwives. I mean, my grandfather was old school. It was like being among the Amish sometimes, you know, when I think about his doctrines and things. I was in the hospital, and this is a true story now. Kelly had been working with a lady doctor there. That's the way it was set up from the beginning. But at the last minute, for whatever reason, she couldn't be there. And suddenly they informed us. And Kelly's not far from giving birth. And they come in the room. It's late at night. I'm in the room with Kelly. And they're like, she's not going to be here. It's going to be a man doctor, you know, after all. And of course, I'm really young. I've been going to this old time holiness church for a while. We were determined it had to be a woman. I was devastated. Ain't no man going to deliver my baby, you know. We had this all planned. This has got to work out this way. I was so devastated. And all of a sudden, I remembered I had a prayer cloth. And I reached back there, and I got that prayer cloth out of my wallet. And I went into the restroom that was in Kelly's hospital room. And I shut the door. And I got on my knees, and I took that cloth. And I said, Lord, I believe. I know there's some power in this cloth. Because a great man of God prayed over this cloth. See, a point of contact to the man of God. These cloths and aprons that Paul was giving out was a contact source to him. No doubt they were thinking, this came from a great man of God, Paul the Apostle. You know, there's got to be some power here. And so I gripped that cloth and I began to pray. And I said, Lord, I'm praying for a miracle, you know. I don't remember my exact words, but that was the gist of it. Lord, I need a miracle. I want a woman to deliver the baby. Like we planned this, you know, I was just tore up in praying. And I got through, put it back in my pocket, opened the bathroom door, walked out, and the door opened up. And a nurse came in, or a doctor, somebody says, well, Frank, he said something like, it's kind of sarcastic. I remember that. Like, well, you ought to be happy now. Such and such happened. So the lady's got to stay here, you know, much later. So she'll be delivering the baby after all. I mean, just like that, you know, the whole situation just turned on a dime. Well, anyway, I hope that meant something to you. It meant a whole lot to me at the time, you know. The prayer cloth, it was a point of contact. It stirred my faith. And no doubt, that's what was going on here so long ago. And that's why they did it back then, and that's why some still do it today. And today, people still report miracles on occasion that come from these sources. So Paul was doing extraordinary miracles at this time, and the word of the Lord was spreading. And as I was prefacing this for the rest of the story here, notice that it tells us in verse on down through verse 13, a little ways down, that these exorcists heard about all of this. And they want to employ the name of Paul and Jesus in their exorcism, right? So it tells us in verse 14, it says, seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. That is, seven of these boys were so-called exorcists. And now they're trying to cast out devils in the name of Jesus that Paul preached. And it tells us in verse 15, it says, but, now notice they just invoke the name of Jesus in Paul. It says, but the evil spirit answering them said, Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize, but who are you? And the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them, mastered all of them, and overpowered them, so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. Now, is that not a story or what? That's pretty wild there. This one possessed man overpowered seven exorcists, beat them up, tore their clothes off, and sent them out of the house streaking. I mean, that had to be a sight, seven guys running out of the house half naked or wholly naked, however it was. you know, running for their lives. But I thought it was just so funny that the Spirit spoke back when they said, "We adjure you by the Jesus that Paul preaches." See, you notice the exorcist didn't have any personal relationship with Christ. He didn't have faith in Christ, but he's invoking, see, like he's invoking the name of a stranger. He's like, you know, the name that Paul preached, Jesus that Paul preached. Instead of saying, you know, in the name of Jesus with confidence and faith, he goes, "I adjure you by the Jesus that Paul's preaching." And the Spirit just spoke to him and said, "Well, Jesus we know, and Paul we know. But you're nobody. We don't know anything about you," in other words. "Your name's not known in hell. We know about Jesus. He's a great and a mighty man of God. He's the Son of God. He walked the earth in power. He raised the dead. He healed the sick. He cleansed the leper. He opened the eyes of the blind. He preached with authority and power. We know him. His name is famous in our ranks. The Bible said if you believe there's one God, you do well. The devils believe and tremble." See, devils know the name of Jesus. They tremble at that name. And they come to know Paul. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? Could you imagine if the devil knew who you were because of your ministry and because of what you were doing for the Lord? That'd be something, wouldn't it? You'd be effective. You'd know you'd done something if Spirit spoke out and says, we've heard of him. But he said, "We ain't heard of you. We don't know you." In other words, you're nobody. You have no power at all. And they leaped on these guys and beat them up and sent them out of the house naked. So that should really be an object lesson for us today, that we serve the Lord in sincerity, and that the name of Christ is not the one that Frank preaches. You know, you don't go away saying, "Yeah, I like that Jesus Frank preaches." Don't think of Jesus as someone you've heard about preached by someone else, but we need to know him personally. That's how it all begins, even with our very salvation. It comes from personal repentance. We come before God personally. We humble our hearts personally before the Lord. We take responsibility for our own sin in the sense we confess it before God. The Bible says if you confess, he'll forgive you. He'll cleanse you from all unrighteousness each and every day for the rest of your life. You know, we can invoke the name of Christ. We can humble our hearts. We have a Savior. The Bible said we have an advocate in Jesus. You know, an advocate, that goes back to like a lawyer, an attorney. You know, they say that he who represents himself has a fool for a lawyer. And that's good advice. Just like anything, there's professionals for everything. And in the courtroom, unless it's just something extremely minor, we need a professional representing us. Jesus is the advocate. He's the lawyer in the courtrooms of heaven. And on the day of judgment, as Third Day says in that song, you know, "I'm going to plead Jesus. I'm going to call on Jesus." And he's the one that will be there to represent us. He'll be there. We won't have to worry about it. You know, the devil, he's the prosecutor. And he's over here and he's got plenty of paperwork. He's got all kind of stuff against us. And he can stand there and say, "I know. I was there. I'm the one that made him do it. He said this on this date, and he did that on that date." And it's all there. But then Jesus steps forward as your advocate and says, "No, it's not there. It's under the blood." For the Bible tells us that our sin is removed from us as far as the east is from the west. And when you think about that, how can you measure that? Someone says, "How far is that?" Well, how far is the east from the west? See, the globe is a circle. East and west is not like north and south. We have a south pole, we have a north pole. You can designate where it's at, pinpoint it. East and west isn't like that. It just goes on and on. So that means it's as far removed as it can be. You know, it says it's put in the sea of God's forgetfulness. He will remember our sins no more. I was reminding my wife of that just the other day, and I'll say this in closing. I was telling her, I said, "Kelly, we have to remember sometimes that he said he will remember our sins no more." If ever we get to feeling bad about the past or a mistake we've made, Apostle Paul said it like this, forgetting those things which are behind, he said, "I look to the things which are ahead. I press forward toward the mark of the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus." One translation says, "I look forward to the upward call in Christ Jesus," because that's where he's calling us. He's calling us upward. You know, the Bible says we are they who dwell in heaven. Our spirits are with Christ. in God, whom the heavens have received, the Bible tells us. But we have an advocate today in Christ, and the Father says He has purposed to remember our sins no more. Once we come to the place of repentance, we get a clean slate. And we may have spent years trying to cover it, hide it, trying not to think about it. You know, and even after you come to Christ, you have a memory, and the memories are there. But you just have to make a conscious effort not to pull them up. You know, it's like file cabinets. Don't go through the file cabinets looking for that file. Just file it away and leave it back there. You know, if somebody reminds you of it, just turn away from those kind of people. You know, don't spend time with people that remind you of your past or remind you of your sinful days. But move away from every person, place, or thing connected to your former life of sin. This is one of the best things we can do as to our part in living a victorious and a successful, guilt-free, peaceful life. We'll find peace with God that way because He has chosen to remember our sins no more, it tells us. Do you believe it this morning? Can we give the Lord Jesus a hand clapping? Well, praise the name of the Lord this morning. He's so good to us. He's so good to us. Though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death sometimes, we have no reason to fear evil, for the Word tells us that He is with us. Will, as Celestria, please come back up to send us off with a song. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. If you would, just bow your heads with me this morning, and let's humble our hearts before the Lord. Because according to the Bible, God works through humility. If we humble our hearts before Him, not before the preacher, not before, you know, the emblems and pictures of crosses, but those things, like I was talking about, the handkerchiefs that Paul was using, they can be a point of contact. Sometimes a preacher, sometimes a picture of a cross or something, sometimes a church building. It might stir our faith, and that's good, but really the power is in the Spirit. The power is in God Himself. He's the one that we want to humble ourselves before. He's the one who loves us today. We change, you know. Our moods change. We can have bad days. I had a rough day yesterday. And sometimes it don't even make sense. Nothing's even happened. It's just, I don't know, maybe it's chemical, you know. It's in the brain. Things aren't firing right. The serotonin levels aren't where they need to be. Whatever the case may be, you know, the Spirit will hover over us like a cloud sometimes, and it takes advantages of weaknesses and things in the brain, and it'll use that sometimes to work on us. But God is a miracle-working God. As He prolonged the man's life in the Bible 15 years because the man humbled himself before the Lord, He can prolong our lives. He can give us health. He can breathe back into us ambition. Give us a vision, a reason to go on, just by humbling our hearts to Him, just by asking Him into our lives, giving Him permission to do something for us. Heavenly Father, we come before You today as Your people, believers, Lord. As the man said in the Bible on one occasion, help our unbelief. As the man wanted to believe, he believed, but he knew his faith was weak. Father, we ask today that likewise You would help us in our unbelief, that You would strengthen our faith, knowing that's our connection to You. That's our connection to the promises. Help us today, Lord. Remind us that You have forgiven and forgotten our sin, and that You look at us as clean, as wholesome. You look at us the way You look at Jesus. Remind us of this, Father. Let this become a consistent reality with us throughout each day of our life. Because it's in this reality, Father, that we find faith and we find strength to know that we're Your children, children of the Most High God, a powerful God that loves us, watching over us, wants to bless us and help us. Father, we open up the avenues for that help today as we open our hearts. We take out of the way the barriers as we move our unbelief. We believe, Father. I invite You in today to touch us, Lord. touch each and every person here, Father. Don't let them leave the way that we came. Watch over our little ones, Lord. Heal them from their sicknesses. Protect them from diseases. Protect us from accident and injury, Lord. You are a Savior. We believe the word when you said you give your angels charge concerning us that they should bear us up lest we dash our foot against a stone. We take it, Father, to be personal. This is your personal word to us. We believe. Make it so today, Father. Bless everyone here, Lord. Help us as we go out this week to our jobs and responsibilities. Give us the wisdom we need to perform them well. Lead us by your Spirit. Never leave us, Lord. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.